Welcome to the Land Cave, where we're living as nerds. I'm here, actually joined by the disembodied voice of Kevin.
Yeah.
There he is. Slight delay.
I do still exist, for those of you who'd miss me.
Still exists due to scheduling conflicts and a lot of things. You know, not able to be on air, but still helping a lot behind the scenes. So welcome back for a nice little tight little show. How do you think this is post E3? We haven't talked a lot since E3. What are your thoughts?
I don't know. It just feels like the lull before the storm. They're like, we've got cool stuff. It's, oh boy, you'll be excited when you see it. But like, I don't know. There wasn't really anything that that I walked away from as, oh, this is going to be my next year. It's just like, okay, cool stuff's coming. And honestly, Devolver Digital, though, absolute favorite part of E3.
Yeah.
That was the best.
That's probably the best. They're continuing to subvert expectations in a show that's all about subverting expectations, which is pretty great.
Right.
I think most of what I liked about E3 has been fan reactions, memes, and just the general reaction, like Keanu Reeves and stuff like that. So,
I'm really happy for him. He seems like he's having a lot of fun.
He is. He's having a great rejuvenation of his career, which I'm really happy about. And I talked about on last week's episode that Marvel's talking to him. I'm still hoping, cross my fingers, that my pick is what Marvel's pick will be as well. But the casting director for Marvel has been the same casting director since 2008. She's been rocking it. So I trust her. I trust her. She cast Jake Gyllenhaal. I mean, come on.
Gyllenhaal was phenomenal. Okay, so are we
running we're not going to spoil on... We're not going to spoil
it. Okay. I loved Gyllenhaal's Mysterio, and I felt that he was probably the strongest point of the he was the strongest character for me.
Yeah.
Romance, I'm like, yeah. It's rough. Ooh, I have feelings.
I like what they're doing with the romance, though, and I like the MJ character in this.
Yeah.
Much better than the previous movie.
I like the overall arc. Feels like it's kind of drawn out.
Yeah, a little bit.
But angst.
Angst.
I will tell you one thing, though, because before E3, during E3, since E3, we just keep hearing about Borderlands 3. And I get more excited about that the less Pitchford talks.
Oh, yeah.
Like, he just needs to just back up and let them finish and do their thing and just, you know, practice.
I agree, and I've been purposely staying away from a lot of the drama that's going on with Pitchford. Just trying to stay out of it. There's some juicy gossip, but I'm not per our journalistic integrity, I'm not going to go into it too far.
The stuff that we're seeing here. Okay, so did you ever get into the Dead Cells Twitch stuff?
A Dead Cells Twitch? No, I didn't.
Okay, so in that, like, you go over to like a chest, and then you have to have the chat like beat it up and stuff, like biff, bam, pow, sock, and they send that, and it beats up and opens the chest for you, and that's how you get cool items, and they like tell you where to go and how to do things, and so that's what the Twitch, I think it's called EchoCast system. I don't know. I can't look at notes right now.
Yeah. You're talking about the ping with Borderlands?
Right, that's from Apex Legends, but I'm talking about the other part.
Not following. I wasn't following that. I'm confused. Okay. But I am excited about the ping feature. It seems like it's just one button that allows, I don't know if it's arrow up or whatever it is. I like that it's one button.
It's the D-pad, and basically everybody's cribbing it from Apex Legends because it works so well. Fortnite had it in... I think
You're breaking out.
So even if the game itself, even if the game itself didn't do that well, Apex Legends did bring the ping system, and like that's just going to be an FPS standard from here on out.
Yeah,
and I like it.
It really is. Yeah, I love it. I didn't realize that it was in Apex Legends until earlier today because I watched some people play it. I'm like, okay, yep, I would get it handed to me on that. I would completely get stomped, so I've just stayed away from it. Yeah. Let me grab my notes real quick. One thing I'm not going to stay away from, by the way, is the Cuphead TV show, starring starring Mugman.
Yeah, and so they said this was going to be like for every audience.
For every audience, yeah, that's.
Yeah, I'm excited about that. That's going to be fun.
Yeah, to bring it. I mean, not that Cuphead, is exclusively adult, because it does kind of have that balance of, I wouldn't know if inappropriateness is even the right term for it, but it does have that balance of, like, it's mature.
They literally make a deal with the devil, and then he like pours XXX.
Sure,
like, it is the old style, and it's interesting how.
Yeah,
which oddly, by the way, problematic, and then not problematic it was, yeah, again.
I will say, speaking of that, Whitney and I have been watching the, it's a relatively new, I think it came out 3 years ago and it's still going on, these Mickey Mouse shorts. So we've been watching these because we watched them last time
where are those?
YouTube,
Netflix?
I don't know where to obtain them streaming-wise. I wish I could pop. I should have thought of it. I didn't think we'd bring it up today on this, but I don't know how to legally obtain them. Whitney and I watched them in a Disney hotel. How about that? We'll leave it at that. They are about two and a half to three minutes long with the credits at the end. Mm-hmm. They're crazy short. They're inappropriate, like verging on Ren and Stimpy inappropriate.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, and he's.
Have you seen these?
Been in places.
Okay, I don't know if you've seen these. Okay, because I had not seen them at all, and we were at a Disney hotel. We were hanging out and flipped, trying to flip through something to find something to watch. Landed on these, and it was inappropriate, but just like leading right up to like, okay, this is wrong. We shouldn't be talking about this, especially with Disney. But it like walked that line, which I really liked. So we've been watching those. Like one where Goofy is like a, they don't say zombie. I mean, he's basically an undead ghoul or whatever you want to call it. And Mickey's car's broken down. I don't know if you've seen that one.
And
Mickey's freaking out because his car broke down and he just sees the zombie, which is Goofy. And Goofy's just chasing him down to give him his arm, literally like rip off his arm and hand it to him to use as a wrench on his car. I love
it. So welcome if you're just now joining us, the Land Cave, where Patrick describes potentially illegally obtainable DVD. But anyway,
I have watched them legally. How's that?
There you go.
So we're talking about E3 and like we keep hearing about like Borderlands. Borderlands was a really poorly kept secret, and so was the Switch Lite. Because we kind of knew this was happening. A lot of us were hoping that it was also going to get a pro version. We have not heard that yet, but Switch.
And they said, that's not what they're looking at right now. This is basically for those that just wanted the portable, the 3DS experience, as it were.
Yeah, and I will say I almost play mine exclusively undocked right now. Good.
Every once in a while, something like Breath of the Wild, I'll want to see on the TV, but for the most part, it's fine.
It's fine. I mean, I have other games that I can play on the screen. I mean, the thing is, I like the flexibility. I have a dock. I have a dock right here next to me. I have a dock in the other room. I like the flexibility. I like being able to dock it. In this case, I like being able to stream it because Nintendo has no way for me to stream unless I dock it and I put it up to HDMI capture. That's the drawback to this. If you get one, then it doesn't have a way to do that.
It's not the first Switch, but if you already have a Switch and you kind of want another one.
I agree. It's a great price point as well. $200 $200 for a Switch.
And so, real quick, if you could look up for me, what was the size of the Vita screen?
I will take a look.
Because I think that was 5.1, so I believe this is a little bit bigger than that screen.
The Vita is... I'm waiting for... Where's the screen? Screen 5.
Okay, so... the screen of the Vita, like, it could show some pretty impressive, good looking features, but I mean, it was good enough to play games all right. And like, yeah, if you're playing The Witcher in 540, your screen doesn't need to be that big.
It doesn't need to be that big. And I've said many times, if you decrease resolution or frame rate, which we don't want to decrease frame rate too low,
right,
for Witcher you can run at 30 or so, it's fine. And
you get the Witcher experience, because yeah, I've been wanting to play this game for so yeah long, and I finally get to play it because it's portable.
Yeah, I have it on my PS4, and I'm still considering buying it because it's portable, because it's so easy.
So The Witcher was one that I got the first Christmas,
mm-hmm,
after I got my Switch. Wow. Or after I got my PS4, rather.
So which you was having, like 3 years ago? Haven't been able to dive into it?
No, because it's so intimidating.
Yeah, it's... Beginning that kind of game, if you start it and you have to devote time for it. I mean, like, Whitney and I are watching Stranger Things Season 2 right now. As you know, and some of the viewers may know, and listeners... I wait to watch things. She waits to watch things. If we know that it's something that the two of us are going to enjoy watching, we wait until we can both watch it. And Stranger Things has literally been on the back burner for, what, 2 years?
Not literally, so, though.
Well, I haven't watched any of it. And Season 2 came out in 2017, right?
Pretty
sure it's 2017.
Yeah, it's Season 3 now.
Yeah, so I'm watching Season 2 now, and I'm hoping to catch up on Season 3, but like, just it wasn't the right timing for it. But The Witcher, like, just like binge watching something, you have to know, okay, this is what's happening, and we're not going to get anything else in the way, because if you do, then you're not going to finish it. And Witcher is,
right, it's intimidating. And it is also something that I want to experience in its entirety.
Mm-hmm.
And so I'm going to get a chance to do that. And yeah, I'm excited about that. And I wasn't there for the graphics. I was there because, you know, anyway.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
But in the news for this week, sorry, I don't have the notes, so I can't do segues without notes.
That's okay. Yeah. Sorry, I thought you were leading up to something randomly. But we're talking about Switches. So one of the difference, by the way, key differences, as we kind of wrap that part up, the key differences on the Switch Lite are, it is smaller, obviously. It does not dock to connect to your TV, and the Joy-Cons are not detachable.
And that's fine. Yeah. I don't care.
That's fine. It leaves it to be, because I don't use the motion on mine. I mean, I'm assuming that they've had to keep some type of gyroscopic capabilities for, like, Zelda Breath of the Wild, where you have to rotate the screen or your Joy-Con, depending on if you're playing it docked. So that's the only thing I can think about. They did say that there is going to be some type of warning, or not warning, but something to... or help you understand which games are going to be playable, because some games
in the video it shows the icon that shows if it's playable on the go, like,
exactly,
without that motion.
Exactly. So that, and that's what you'd have to, if it is playable on the go, then you can play it there. If not, you're SOL. So I think it's good though. But it's funny enough that they're removing the removable Joy-Con functionality, so they're built in. Microsoft has patented a controller, which looks like they're foldable controllers that are more than likely going after the mobile market, because xCloud is happening. And because xCloud is happening, I think they want less of an excuse for anyone who could connect to it to have some type of excuse. The more... I always say the easier it is, the more easy it is for the average user, the more people will adopt it. You're going to get the fringe people like us who spend hours getting something exactly right, exactly the way that we want it to, but you're not going to get the general public with that. You have to get it very easily. Like I set up a Plex server, I don't know, a couple months ago or I guess a month ago, whatever. I'm loving it. I explained it to one of Whitney's coworkers about how cool it is. Her eyes just glazed over about the steps that it takes. Didn't seem that crazy to me, but the steps that it took were like, no, that's nuts. I'm never going to touch that. Like, I think she literally said, that's cool for everyone other than me or something like that. Like, it needs to be something that's even more accessible, which is why Netflix is so great. Netflix is great because you don't have to set up anything. You just click the button and you do the thing. So,
But the thing about this is like how they're working with, like they're working with Sony, they're working with, their Games Pass. Like, I feel like, they're moving towards, you know, xCloud, your games are everywhere, here's controllers. Like, I like the direction they're going with this, and I like the way that they're viewing this as an extension of Xbox and not the other way around. I appreciate the framework that they've set up to support this system, and so I'm honestly looking forward to, when I have time, getting into that, because they're making it very easy to get to a lot of stuff that I missed.
Agreed. They're making it easy, and I think that they know that they have to do that, because if they don't lay the groundwork, then Google will take over. I have an Xbox. I have not yet, but I'm going to pre-order Stadia. I think it's great. I think it's a really cool option. There are a lot of games that I think would be really cool to play on that I would normally play on a console. I'm interested to see what kind of free games they're going to give out to it, because it's so, the accessibility for it is just remarkable. So I'm excited about that. And if Xbox can do it as well, then they have more of a baked-in audience. If they can do it as well and they can do it as good. So I'm hopeful. Pinging back to Nintendo, because I should have talked about this before. Nintendo has added the rewind feature to their classic games, which, you know, this is great, because I will say I play some classic games on there, and I use the save state to go back if I screw something up.
And if I'm not mistaken, that was first introduced on the mini consoles that they had, right?
Yep, it was.
And so it's really cool to see that feature brought to these, because that makes it more likely for somebody like me to be willing to take on something like Zelda without looking stuff up, because I've never beaten the original.
I haven't.
And
either.
I think that'll be fun.
Yeah.
Speaking of older games, we have Dr. Mario, Dr. Mario Worlds. Have you played it?
I have not. Okay, thinking about it.
So, interesting thing is, when it popped up, it was not co-produced with DNA. It's two other companies.
I didn't realize that.
Yeah, I didn't realize it either. But while he's looking up the information on that, on those companies, I will tell you, I beat the first 20 levels or so. I unlocked Bowser. I got like a Goomba buddy and stuff. It's an interesting puzzle game. I like the directions and the twists, and that it feels like it just keeps getting more complex and setting up multiple moves, and then being able to move pills around after that is, I don't know, it's a really fun game, and the monetization doesn't seem nearly as harsh as some of theirs can be, and it's not like a gotcha as much as some of their other money-making ventures have been.
Yeah.
Or at least that's how it seems so far.
So it's made in conjunction with Line and NHN.
That's the one that sounded familiar to me.
Sounded familiar to me too, and I'm looking up the games, but I'm not familiar with any of these games.
Okay. So if anybody in the comments, because we're live on Facebook, hi! if anybody's in the comments has been playing it, let us know what you think about it.
Yep. Yeah. Owen said Dr. Mario World sucks. He just messaged in the chat. So there you go.
I don't know. I like the puzzles.
I like puzzle games. I haven't pulled the trigger on that yet. I got Hyrule Warriors. I've not played it yet, but I have it. I'm gonna play it because I've been waiting similarly to, as we were talking about, like Stranger Things, not waiting for Whitney, but similar to, I guess, what you're doing with Witcher. I know that when I play Hyrule, Cadence of Hyrule, I know that when I play that, I need the music on.
Oh, yeah.
And because of that...
Because like, the more you can get into the music, the more you're going to get into the game.
Exactly, exactly. So I'm waiting to play it. It's loaded. It's ready. About to take a business trip starting Sunday. So that'll be something that's on my Switch while I'm doing that. And so next week's show, depending on what happens, will be a... Either way, it'll be a remote show. So we're going to figure that out. We're still going to have a show.
Stay tuned. We'll figure something out.
Yeah, we will. We will.
We always do.
Yeah. We talked about Borderlands. Talked about that. We had some clarification on the Evil Dead game I wanted to talk about real quick. Because I love Evil Dead. And I love Bruce Campbell. Apparently, there were rumors. I didn't see that he leaked this. But his tweet sounded like he was apologizing for a leak. Because he tweeted out saying this is for PC and consoles, but it is not VR.
It's not really a whole lot of extra news, but it is just one more confirmation of kind of like you were talking about earlier with Borderlands 3 being a poorly guarded secret. It was like somebody's working on it. I think THQ Nordic has the rights right now, and they've been reviving some excellent franchises, and so I think that they have the possibility to do something interesting with the Evil Dead series.
I just think I hope they're better than the other games. I was not happy. I mean, as a huge fan, I got the one on PlayStation, and
were not good times.
I made myself play it just because it was Evil Dead, and it was not good. They also had Ash in Dead by Daylight, which I thought was really cool. So it's not the first time he's jumped into video games. He's been doing it. He will milk this character till the end of time, which I'm completely fine with.
I mean, it's what he does.
Yeah.
He comes and he chews.
It's basically him. So I think it's easy. It's fun for him. So just, you know, why not? Why not? It's what Keanu Reeves is experiencing now, where he can just be himself and people love it.
Yeah.
So I love it. We had one last bit of news.
Go ahead. As a bit of just advice to our audience, be yourselves.
Yeah. It always pays to be yourself. It really does.
Well,
it really does.
I don't know about always. Bit of hyperbole.
Always be the best version of yourself. And you keep striving towards
that. Yes.
And then people will be like, oh, this person's so great. I've loved them all the time. Even when they said they didn't like you. Yeah. That all comes around. So G2A, if you're not familiar with G2A, if you're a console...
What? Real quick. Before we go to GTA... GTA.
G2A.
GTA, G2A, similar business principles. Aziz Ansari.
Yep.
Right now on Netflix. Watch that.
Okay.
It seems like he's really taken some time off and grown. And yeah, everybody check that out. Excellent piece on Netflix.
Well, without getting into everything that was going on with his Me Too movement version, honestly, it wasn't great, but he didn't assault anybody. So like, I hate that he got backlash because his was a really awkward bad date.
He talks about the growth that he made. I think that's the difference between he and Louis C.K. Louis C.K. was just like, I'm back, I apologize. It's like, right. And then Aziz talks about how he grew during that time and how we're all kind of in a period of growth right now.
Yeah. Yeah, which I think
the world is changing really fast.
And I think it's important
to grow quick.
You have to grow quick, and you have to realize that everything you do and say can be held against you, even though you thought that no one remembered it. If you tweeted it, if you
like
whatever happened.
Like G2A. Like G2A. It's now out in public that they are writing articles about themselves and saying, hey, here, just put this on the side. Don't say it was us. Like, really?
Yeah, we want you to publish it. We literally said we want you to publish on our website without being marked as sponsored or associated. So that is not legal here.
No.
But they're in Russia. If you didn't know that, G2A is from Russia.
It makes sense.
So
like, it's just one of those facts that you learn. You're like, Yeah, that checks out.
Yep, that makes sense. So for those of you who don't know, G2A is a place you can buy Steam keys. I mean, they don't say it's for Steam keys, but they basically are Steam keys. You can choose what platform you want.
They say that they're Steam keys. The questionable aspect is where they acquire them.
Yes, no, I'm just saying, like, you can get things other than Steam keys. You can get things other than Steam keys. And they have to be used or something, because I will say, I'm not going to defend them, but they do mention, and everyone has mentioned, like, that if you the idea that people thought was what's happening with them is that someone buys up a bunch of keys for a specific game, they hand out those keys, and they wait for a couple months, and then they request a refund. They say, oh, my credit card was hacked, or whatever. But if you do that, then all those games are deactivated, and you get caught very quickly. So I don't know if that's the only way. It can't be the only way it's being done. I do agree with them on that, because of the security that companies use.
Well, and everybody knows they're scummy. Everybody knows they've been scummy. And so the news for this week, for those of you who are following along, the news this week is that indie devs are like, listen, just pirate the games. If you're going to buy them from them, just pirate them. Yeah. Because this is taking up our support team's time.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. Just go pirate it.
Yeah.
So for those of you who have been waiting for an authorization to pirate, here it is, I guess.
I will say, I got GTA 5 there, and I had previously, so I've purchased GTA 5 on Xbox 360, I purchased it on PS4, and I was waiting to buy it on PC, and decided, you know what, I'm just going to grab it off of G2A, because they were selling it for $13. And I've not seen it go lower than, I don't know, maybe 17 to 19 elsewhere, because it still sells, yeah. So they're not dipping it too low, because they know at $20 they're still going to get people. So I don't use it very often. I did it for that, because I know that's not going to that's really not going to hurt them. But for an indie dev, yeah, I mean, especially with Steam, we've talked about Steam's their profit margin that companies get off of Steam versus Epic. I agree. Epic would be great for indie developers had it not been for some of the things that they're doing recently. So if you're taking an indie game that's on Steam and you're getting it off G2A instead of that, they're getting no money whatsoever off of that.
And they say, you know, it supports them and enables them to try to look legitimate.
Yeah. Owen asked what's illegal. What I was referring to, I said that's
well,
illegal.
Well, hold on.
I wanted to answer Owen here. Owen asked what I said what was illegal. If you have a video or a report and you are, and it is something that has been given to you by a company that you're talking about, you have to disclose that it was given to you. That's something that YouTubers and a bunch of other people have gotten in trouble for, because they will have essentially, it's like having a, you know, Stranger Things just was hawking Coca-Cola products the whole time. They don't have to tell you, but they have to disclose it elsewhere. But during YouTube or print media, they have to tell you this was sponsored by this. Movies and TV shows are a different story. They can tell you on the back end. Yeah.
Yeah. Was he asking if... Okay.
He was asking for me to clarify what was illegal, because I said that's illegal.
About their business. Just everything. If G2A is doing it, it's probably illegal.
It could be. I want to know how if they're doing it off used keys or resold keys.
There were also people who, like, whenever credit cards get stolen, mm-hmm. they buy a bunch of Steam keys and then dump those Steam keys on G2A. Yeah. G2A resells them, and then whenever the credit card comes back, takes it out of that account, and
that's true. And then I thought Steam would then go deactivate any of the Steam keys used for it.
Yeah, that's true. And then they would go and complain to the devs, and it's like, we didn't sell you a thing.
Yeah.
You haven't paid us any money. Yep. And so, yeah, they were like, yeah, just go pirate it.
Exactly.
So, yeah, it's kind of the next level ethics because of the economics of the situation.
Yeah.
They're like, yeah, just go pirate it. It's fine. Who has time to play the games that they buy?
My Steam library is over 200 games, and they're games that I really am glad that I have in my collection. And I hope that they don't, I hope they don't remove them from their store and that I can't download them, because I have hardly any of them on my PC, but
yeah.
A lot of games, a lot of classic games, yeah, or games I really wanted to dive into.
Yeah, I've got like 400 something on PS4, because that's just my home system and has been for a while.
One day.
What else we have?
That's it. That's all for the news.
All right. So usually we start with this. What have you been playing?
Honestly, I've been crazy busy, so I've been playing, I've just been playing Magic the Gathering when I have time, and some Dark Souls, playing a strength build through Dark Souls. I played a, faith-based build, but I got stuck in the, what is it? I think it's, is it Nito? I think is the guy's name? N-I-T-O? I haven't been able to beat him. But yeah, doing pretty good on that. But well, switched over to the health, to the strength build. Yeah,
the Mario Maker has been fascinating both on YouTube and in the game, because the level of creativity has just been really fun, and the UI is not great. It's a pain. We're still having to use codes and everything because it's Nintendo. But I've been able to find some really cool puzzles, and I don't know if you saw this. Game Theory made a working calculator in Mario Maker.
Oh, that's interesting.
They can add up to 7.
That's awesome.
That's pretty cool. Yeah, it was. So whatever Game Theory scrolls across your channel with that one.
Yeah.
Definitely give that one a watch.
Yeah, I'll check that out. Owen says he's 24 hours into Persona 5. This is one of the things he was planning on playing on his vacation, so he's happy about that.
Speaking of Persona 5, Persona 5 is becoming a studio play in Japan.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I just found out, like, right as we started recording, so.
Yeah. Interesting. So the news just keeps coming. That's why you gotta stay tuned to our channel when we're on it, at least. We don't have a channel. You need to be on our Facebook. You need to follow us on Facebook and Twitter. We're The Land Cave everywhere on YouTube.
Follow us at all the places.
All the places, even a podcast. If you like listening to podcasts, we are also a podcast, so you can get that there.
And see us in the Wizards Unite. Have you been playing that on your phone?
No, I haven't.
Okay.
No.
So I like it because it's a little bit of skill-based.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I've seen it. I know that if I play that, I'm going to have to, like, purposely, like, plan trips around to, you know, to go do stuff because I don't have anything around me, and I'm home.
Oh.
I'm home okay. most of the day. I'm home most of the day and most evenings, so working from home, you really can feel claustrophobic sometimes.
Okay. Well, I'm glad you get to go travel then.
Yeah, I'm excited about it. And then travel for work and then travel for vacation and then new house shortly after that, we'll see. Fingers crossed.
But whatever happens in our lives, we bring you the news.
That's right. See you later.